This is Tracy with RoadDawgOnline.com and Jeff Potter of the Lost Trailers.
What's up, y'all?
So a group getting going in country music, not a put-together group. You guys have been together for a while, right?
Yeah, we've been together. I've known these guys since high school. We've been together officially as the Lost Trailers since 2001 when Willie Nelson discovered us, put us on his 4th of July picnic. And
what a break that was, huh?
Absolutely, yeah. And from that day, July 4th on, 2001, whatever the date was, that was it. We were on. By the way, the Lost Trailers got their name because we had three trailers worth of equipment.
So oh, no.
Yeah. When you know guys for as long as we have, you get to learn them inside and out. I've been singing vocals with Ryder since high school choir, man.
Oh, and, yeah.
So, and I do the harmonies for the band and Jason is playing drums. So, it's been, so I kind of know where I have to sit, you know. And
it's almost like brothers, man. You've been there so long, you know where to fit.
It's a really important thing musically, and also with, you know, when you have a band, it's your passion, it's your business, it's your livelihood, it's everything. You just build this kind of empire, just this all-encompassing thing, you know, and you have loved ones that come into it. I mean, your family gets into it, mm-hmm. everything like that. So, I mean, you know, in order to be successful in that, you've got to know the guys, you got to be friends with them, you got to be happy with them.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's something that we're fortunate enough to have known each other long enough and be compatible in that respect, and also, you know each other inside out musically and be able to, you know, to make great music with each other.
How did you guys form back in the day?
Well, like I said, we went to the same high school, and, you know, you kind of knew everybody that was playing music, you mm-hmm. know? So
where'd you grow up, by the way?
I grew up in Maryland.
Okay.
Yeah, a couple of guys, one's from North Carolina, one's from Georgia. So the band, we got shipped off to a religious school for, uh-huh. You know, not being the best of kids. But so being there, you know, you had a strict regimen, so you got a certain amount of time during the night to go do whatever you want, socialize and whatnot, and everybody would eventually just go down to the basement of an old chapel and play music. It's where you had the drum set set up and all that stuff. So, yeah, man. So that was my musical education, and that's where I learned how to play with other guys, you know, in a band officially. And so that's kind of where it started. You know?
Yeah, as far as drumming, man, when did you get started doing that?
You know, I was in eighth grade, and I asked for a kid for my birthday. Before that, there was a couple of the guys in my elementary school that were like, let's start a band or whatever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it kind of just came down to, I was the one that had the best rhythm, so we decided that I was going to be the drummer. So I asked my parents, God bless them, they got me a drum kit, you know, and put up with the noise,
yeah,
and set up in the basement, and it really took, you know, it's, and whether, and I've always felt musical, you know, musically inclined. I've always had an interest. I mean, learned the guitar for a little bit. Mm-hmm. You know, I'd always played, you know, whatever my mom wanted me to play.
Yeah,
cello.
Well, that probably helped you out playing drums, knowing the melodic side of it too.
You have to, I think. I think as a drummer, I've always felt that your purpose is twofold. It's to set the beat, but it's also to complement what else is going around you. Where, you know, whether it be accentuating somebody's guitar lick or vocal line or something, or filling in the gaps between when they're playing. And I don't think you can be illiterate, you know, musically illiterate to somebody else's, what they're doing. You've got to know.
So what is the band process like, necessarily, for you guys? Who's the songwriter? What's the input level of each? How's it all working?
Stokes primarily is the songwriter. Well, he is the songwriter for this band for most of the songs. We've cut some outside cuts, but, you know, he has the majority of the songs. He writes the majority of the songs. And Ryder has teamed up with Soaps recently. Yeah, pretty much the way that songs come about, you know, when Stokes will write a song, you know, we'll hear it usually sometimes in sound check. If he's working on something, he'll kind of it's pretty cool to watch how he writes the songs, because he'll work out some of the stuff in soundcheck, and then, you know, I'll start laying a drum beat to it, and sometimes things come about like that.
Yeah.
Now sometimes he's written a song, and we get to the studio, and that's the first time that I hear it, which is also cool, because I think, you know, there's a lot of merit to taking a song and road testing it to see whether or not people even like it, you know, and if they don't, you know, maybe it goes on the shelf. But there's also the side where you just hear it for the first time and then just go with it, you know, see where it takes you. So, you know, that's creatively, you know, all I can do is just put down the best drum track that I possibly can to it, and then, you know, in the studio, just kind of think of other things that'll sound cool musically. You know, maybe we should have 12-string guitar on this, mm-hmm. or something like that. You know? The studio process is—it's great. It's work though. It really takes a lot to be able to be patient enough to where you first have that first session to the completion of the song, to keep your ears fresh, to keep your mind fresh, to really just approach it how you first did, where you're like, let's make this the best song that it can, without getting too bogged down and just staring at the Pro Tools screen,
yeah.
you know, and being like, well, that doesn't line up, and not thinking with your ears, you know. What you want to do, what our biggest challenge was because we've always started by touring, so our biggest challenge was to take what we think we sound like and come off like live, that all that energy, and put it into a record. Well, we successfully did that, I think, with Holler Back, in the name of the album, and in the single Holler Back, and in the other tracks on that album. So now it's to come out and be like, well, you did a good job there, let's do what we do, but also let's make it sound like the record too, you know, because people want to hear that. So you do that as best you can, but there's always, you know, there's little things, there's transitions between songs, there's the way that he plays the guitar solo, you know, there's the guitar solo, there's the drum fill that I didn't think of when I recorded it, that I just did one time and I think is awesome, and I'm going to do it every time. The tour that we're running is called the Lean, Clean, and Local Tour, and it came about while we were touring this past year. We were talking to, we had done a fly day, basically, which means we fly into the city and use backline and use all local tours, and we were talking to the one of the guys, one of the crew members that was working there, and he thanked us for using local crew, and he said, I've been out of work for 3 weeks here, so I'm just glad that you guys are using us, and it kind of sparked something to where when you visit all these cities as a musician, as a band, you you have such available talent locally,
mm-hmm.
which it's economical for you to purchase, and it's also, it puts money into the community. So that's a big facet of the way we're focusing on touring. The other aspect is instead of, the CO2 emissions that are involved with carrying a bus all over the country, we've been using commercial airlines and getting to these different destinations and cut down on your CO2, your carbon footprint in that respect. And, you know, it's more economical for the band to be able to travel that way. You can also route yourself,
mm-hmm.
You can be in Greenville on Friday night and get to Houston on Saturday night, where, you know,
yeah.
you can't really do that if you're bringing full production.
Right,
and,
that's true.
And the tour bus and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So just getting cranking on, we've partnered with Keep America Beautiful, who will be out at various shows. An energy-packed live performance with a lot of crowd interaction, with some definite highs. Every night is different. Unfortunately, I can't move, but the other guys, it's like when we finally got wireless packs, it's like that gave them permission to basically, you know, I'm surprised we haven't started zip lining yet, but so climbing on things.
Jeff, thank you.
Thanks,
so much,
Tracy.
For your time.
It's been my pleasure.
And congratulations on the ACM nomination.
Thank you. Appreciate
I'll keep
that.
My fingers crossed for you guys. Man.
All right.
And good luck on the road.
Thanks for checking out RoadDawgOnline.com.
He just finished it up for me. This is Tracy and Jeff.
Peace.
and we're done.